So friends, now we talk about cooperation and conflict. Again, an introduction. We will take up more of these things later. And this is, in a way, the last lecture in the series of discussion of individual and society. After that, we will take up concrete topics like family, religion, social stratification, and so on. In a way, this lecture is redundant. As a student of engineering, you always want to introduce some redundancy in the system. So this discussion is redundant in the sense that this is meant only for clarifying the subject matter of sociology more, and especially with regard to theories of society. Society has individuals, society has groups, society itself is a group, and society is part of world society. I was telling you that maybe at one time world was not seen as a society, but today we will see world as a society, and that's why oftentimes people talk about global village. Village is a community. How can globe be a village, a community? Yes. Increasingly, globe has not become a community, but globe is in the process of becoming a community. The day you start identifying with the global village, in the same sense in which you identify, or people identified with their village community 500 years ago, the world will become a global village. It does not become global village only just because some intellectuals, professors, businessmen, executives, politicians move from one country to another. World will become a global society and a global village when you will start identifying with the interest of the whole globe or the whole community of mankind, You see all men and women of the world as your brothers and sisters. Okay? As in village, you see other men and women as your brothers and sisters. A time may come when, and several people have been trying in this direction. In our country, some political leaders like Lohia, Ram Manohar Lohia, they were trying to champion the cause of world citizenship, international order, peaceful order. Toward the end of his life, he kept on talking, more about the internationalism than taking up national issues. So the moment people start identifying with the world, and the world becomes liberal in economic sense, there is a free flow or free mobility of people and capital from one country to another. The moment people of one country interact frequently with people belonging to other countries, more people-to-people interaction. Poets going to other countries, artists going to other countries, intellectuals, professors, business executives, artisans going from one country to another country, interacting with people. The moment interaction between people of different world increases, the world will become a global community. Also, more our behavior is regulated by norms, institutions, norms, folk ways, taboos, mores created in the context of internationalism for everyone, for humans. The moment we start talking of norms in favor of the whole human society, we are moving towards the concept of world society. And there are indications that we are moving in that direction. Every country is talking about millennium development goals, that by 2000, this infant mortality in our country should be halved. By year this, and years are specified. Degree by which indicators must change is also identified. Different countries are at different levels of poverty, infant mortality, maternal mortality, literacy or illiteracy, employment, malnutrition, anemia. But Millennium Development Goals gives us a framework in which we can see that in our country, by this year, next 5 years, next 10 years, next 20 years, these indicators must change by this much amount. So if there are rules like this, which the whole world follows, then the world has become a community. Then United Nations, Security Council, UNICEF, international organizations like Population Council, Horizon, charity organizations, religious organizations working worldwide, and even terrorism, spread of terrorism to entire world. When terrorism is spreads to entire, if terrorism is confined only to one or two countries, it doesn't help in making the world a community. But the moment terrorism is spread to the entire world, then it becomes a common problem of all the people of the world. And so all the people of the world will have to respond in a definite manner to face the challenge of terrorism. That will also unify the world community. So the moment we have more interaction, identity, rules and regulations, norms, folkways, mores, no matter in which country you go, you find that the quality of pizzas in Domino Pizza is same, behavior of staff is same, the equipment are same or similar, the inputs used are similar, and the manners and etiquettes of people sitting there and eating, they are also similar. We have become a world society. So not in all respects, but if you see the trend, direction in which we are moving in the direction in which influence of village community on us, or neighborhood on us, becomes less, and influence of world society or world community becomes more. We are citizens of the world. So world becomes society. Now regarding theories of society, although I have already mentioned them, but again I will spend some time, and I will explain these now by taking different examples and slightly different. I will treat this subject slightly differently. One thing I have said is that human behavior is learned. That is why we talk of society. Behavior is learned. And this learning takes place in society. Human behavior is learned, and lots of examples. You read different textbooks of sociology, they give different examples of children raised in the wood, or raised by wolves, or raised by animals, and these stories suggest that children who were raised outside human society did not develop into a normal human being. In one book of Haralambos, I find one interesting example that Akbar was convinced that if human beings are not corrupted by society, they will speak the language of God. And for Akbar, the language of God was Hebrew. Language of God is Hebrew. As for many of us in India, language of God is Sanskrit. Gods speak in Sanskrit. For Akbar, the language of God was Hebrew. So he made an experiment. In the past also, people used to perform experiments. Akbar made an experiment. He selected a group of children, and they were raised by deaf and dumb people. So their mind is not corrupted by influences of human languages. They were not taught Urdu, they were not taught Hindi, they were not taught Arabic and Persian, they were not taught Sanskrit, no language. They were raised by deaf and dumb people. And the experiment showed that these people, they neither spoke the language of God nor any other language. So this example is also given to suggest that human behavior is learned. And what we learn in a social setting, in family, among peers, in schools. And this learning means that the older members of society pass on their learning to new members of society. So this passing on of learning, in short, learning from one generation. To another generation. This is what maintains society. This is what maintains culture, learning. Everything, all our behavior is learned, and learning is passed on from one generation to another. It is in this sense we say that India is the oldest civilization. Membership has been completely replenished. You do not know the greatest historical research cannot tell us who lived in India in this part of the country for 500 years ago. We don't know. But we know that in many respects, values, beliefs, social organization, attitudes of those people who inhabited this part of India 500 years ago were very similar to values, beliefs, and ideas and behavior of those who are living in this part of the country today. There is similarity. It is in this sense that we say that Indian civilization is 5,000 years old. So there is passing on of learning. Learning includes many things. Now this culture, to understand this culture further, the culture can be divided into two parts. There is a material culture and there is a non-material culture. I am only using different words, but I am not saying anything new. I have already said all these things. Non-material culture. In non-material culture, again you can make two divisions, cognitive. In psychology, the term cognitive means mental. And another part is normative. These are the things which we learn. Cognitive means knowledge. Knowledge, information. Mental aspect, all mental aspects. And normative means rules and values. Okay. This is what culture means. Culture has two aspects, material culture and non-material culture. Non-material culture can be further divided into two parts, cognitive, mental, brain, and a social, normative. You know that something very simple, you know knowledge. You know that the name of wife of Ram was Sita. Tulsidas also knew this. Same knowledge for hundreds of years, same knowledge. Valmiki also knew this. Now you can say for thousands of years, the same knowledge. How do we know what Valmiki knew? How do we know what Tulsidas knew? Because this knowledge has been passed to us from our previous generation. From generation to generation, we pass the knowledge, information. Some people take some religious information to be as true as scientific information. You know, for many believers in India, the belief that if you keep fast on Monday, then Lord Shiva will be happy and all desires of yours will be fulfilled is as scientific a truth as the motions of equations of motion. As for scientists, three equations of motion are scientifically correct. For you, they are scientific. Scientific, you have a strong belief that they are correct. You cannot prove them wrong. You cannot prove V equal to U plus AT wrong. For many people in India who are religious kind, it's a scientific fact that if you keep fast on Monday and pray to Lord Shiva, then Lord Shiva will be happy and all your desires will be fulfilled. This is for them a scientific law. Or if or some people may go to Panditji, astrologers, and consult palmists or numerologists. Or some priests may tell them that actually if you pray Hanumanji, then all your problems will go. Keep fast on Tuesday and don't eat salt. And they know, many people know this. Many people know that if you go to Shirdi ka Sai Baba, or if you go to Tirupati temple, have darshanam of Tirupati ka temple. I had a friend, and these beliefs are not confined to poor or illiterate people. The community of IIT, IIT Kanpur also believes in those things. I had a Muslim friend who believed that if he goes to Ajmer and offers a chadar on the dargah of Ajmer Sharif, he will get a son. And he went there and he actually got a son. He was very happy. His belief was further strengthened. So in several cases, actually when you have such religious beliefs, your desires are either fulfilled or they are not fulfilled. Religion, how does religion perpetuate? If your desire is fulfilled, then your belief is strengthened. It becomes more scientific. Then your belief that by going to dargah of Ajmer Sharif, you will get a son, and you get a son, your belief is further strengthened. It becomes more scientific. So information is passed on from generation to generation.
Sir, there are many Hindu people who actually don't know about Muslim religion, but they still go to Ajmer Sharif and they do the same thing. What are their beliefs like?
Yes, because in India, for historical reasons, we have a society in which people belonging to almost all world religions have lived together for hundreds of years. And we have learned things from each other. So today you find that in the country, among commoners, there is much more inter-religious mixing. And there is much more inter-religious exchange of thoughts. And there are also inter-religious faiths. For example, you can't say that Sufism belongs to Islam only. Today, Sufi songs are liked by everyone. Sufi beliefs, many Sufi beliefs are beliefs to which everyone subscribes. If you go to Ajmer Sharif, you find that not only Muslims, but also Hindus go there. I have gone to Ajmer Sharif. When I was a child, I remember that whenever I fell sick, my mother would take me to a local graveyard of Shia sects of Muslims where Muharrams are buried. And she believed that if we go to that graveyard of some Muslims, if we go to that graveyard and we offer some sweet, the local variety of sweet was batasa. A local sweet, and if we offer batasa and we pray there, then our desires will be fulfilled. So we were Hindus, but my mother took me to the dargah. There are in many districts of UP, same thing must be true for other parts of the country also. There are some famous dargahs of Sufi saints where both Muslims and Hindus go, and they have the common belief systems. Similarly, there are many Muslims who celebrate. Actually, Muslims should celebrate all Hindu festivals. 80% or more of Muslims are converts from Hindus only. So it's only in the process of Islamization after conversion that they start thinking that their ancestors came from Persia or Arab. But actually, 80% or more Muslims, this is written by Muslim scholars themselves, that Muslims are only converts from Hindus. So their ancestors were Hindus only. And there are many Muslims who participate in celebration of Deepavali and Holi. There are many Sikhs who go to Vaishno Devi temple. And there are almost all Hindus in Punjab and Haryana who visit Gurdwaras. So if we did not have a corrupt political system, perhaps our society would be, our civil society would be much more mature and much more secular and plural and much more intermixing type. If today we have some kind of hatred developing among different types of communities, I would say that is more for political reasons. Otherwise, at one time, we had much more intermixing of religious and other communities. These two, perhaps in some seasons, more Hindus go to Ajmer Sharif than Muslims. And other dargahs also. When I go to visit a relative of mine in Sahibabad, I get down at Ghaziabad and take an auto or something. I was told that in between there is a dargah. I'm forgetting name of that Sufi saint. And there people believe that their desires are fulfilled. All there is a large congregation of people, mostly Hindus. My brother, I have a brother-in-law who runs a business in Kenya. And every year he comes to India to visit the dargah of Ghaziabad only, a Muslim saint's dargah. He believes, so in India we are secular, plural society, and because of intermix, because of the fact that we have interacted, you know, sociological term interaction, because Hindus and Muslims and Christians and Sikhs and all interacted together for a long time and cooperated with each other for a long time, fought with each other for a long time, and we have the experience, good and bad, of both cooperation and conflicts. So civil society of India is quite secular and intermixed. The problems are being created more by the political class. So there is a cognitive part, information, mental, and there is a normative part. Rules means norms and values. There are two parts of the non-material culture. And this also means that if you go to a different culture, I broke this, I brought something to show it to you. There is a small bulb kind of thing with some holes on that. This is made by earth in villages of Africa. I had brought this to show. I wanted to show that none of you will recognize that because you have not seen that ever. Now that that earthen flute-like globe is part of African culture, and that is part of material culture of Africa that also interacts with these things. So there is a knowledge, there is a knowledge part, there is a belief part. So behind everything, if I take this thing and go to a remote tribal area of Northeast, where people have never seen this, what will they think of this? We recognize things because they are part of our culture. Objects, material, artifacts, manufactures, they are part of material culture, and that interacts with this and this on the basis of certain knowledge that is produced and that is supposed to be used for certain purposes. And certain purposes and certain type of knowledge, technology, knowledge leads to production of certain things. That is, everything is part of culture. So culture can be, at this stage I remember that one anthropologist said that this non-material culture. And the fact that human behavior is learned and information is passed on from one generation to another does not mean that culture does not change. Culture also changes. And different aspects of culture can change at different rates. One anthropologist suggested that if you look at your socio-cultural problems, then you will find that the root cause of those problems is that changes in material culture are faster than changes in non-material culture. Change in material culture is more rapid than in non-material culture. This, and he gave the concept of cultural lag for this. If culture can be broadly divided into two categories, material and non-material, it has been observed that material culture changes at a fast rate or faster rate than the rate at which non-material culture changes. And that is at the root of several problems of socio-cultural type. To give you an example of this, as far as artifacts of modernity are concerned, some examples, say computer, television, and in television again there are so many developments, modern furniture, modern wood, other electronic gadgets, air conditioned cars. These are manufacturers, part of material culture, scientific culture, technological culture, culture of modern societies. There is no objection in any part of the world. There is no conflict with religious groups or castes or communities or racial groups or ethnic groups or tribal, non-tribal, North America, South America, there is no conflict in all parts of the world, or atom bomb or nuclear bomb. Nuclear bomb is part of material culture. Everyone wants nuclear bomb. There is no opposition. So material culture can travel at a very fast rate. Material artifacts get accepted at a very fast rate. Everyone wants them. Modernity is associated with them. But when it comes to non-material culture, then there are problems. So you, from time to time, you find that on issues of non-material nature, there are conflicts. There is complete cooperation as far as the material culture is concerned. No Hindu, no Muslim, no Christian, no Sikh, no Jew will oppose development of medicines to treat cancer or cardiovascular diseases or infections, skin diseases, tuberculosis. Everybody will welcome them. But when it comes to new ideas, ideas of humanism, say civil law. How is civil law Hindu? When we talk of uniform civil code in India, uniform does not mean Hindu. Actually, nothing means Hindu. Hindus are so diverse, so different from each other. And I gave the example of marriage yesterday. Marriages between blood relatives are very common in South. Actually, they are the preferred form of marriages. And marriages between blood relatives are discouraged in much of North India. So what is Hindu about it? Nothing. Similarly, food habits. In many parts of the country, Hindus even eat beef. You may not know, but this is a true. If you talk to a Keralite Hindu will not be shocked to find that Hindus eat beef, because in Kerala, Hindus can eat beef. In UP, majority of Hindus, or at least those who lived Sanskritized style of life, would not eat non-vegetarian items. But Brahmins are Hindus. Brahmins of Bengal, Brahmins of hilly regions, Brahmins of various parts of the country will eat non-vegetarian items. They will sacrifice goats, they will eat goats, they will eat chicken, they will eat fish. Again, there is nothing which there is no single rule. I think no single book, no single idea, nothing can unify all Hindus. The only thing that they are not anything else. They are Hindu. Hindu is a residual category. So if in that context you talk of uniform civil code, it's not Hindu. But Muslims who have no objection to material culture will have a strong objection to uniform civil code. Why? Because the non-material culture does not change at that point. A time may come, as I said, that we are moving in the direction of making society a world, as a world society, a community. So a time may come, and if mankind survives, I am sure that a time will come when the whole world will believe in the same non-material culture rules. And these rules and values will be humanistic and only humanistic. The moment you have world society, you become only a citizen of the whole world. You cannot remain Indian or Pakistani or Hindu or Muslim. And we find evidence of that. Increasingly, we are becoming a human being. We are defining ourselves as a human being. We are becoming a world citizen. It does not matter to us. We may get education at IIT Kanpur, but that does not prevent us from working in New York or Mexico or Moscow or Germany or Paris. We are becoming world citizens. And the moment we become world citizen, our behavior will be governed more by rules and values of world citizenry. We will become world citizen. So what is wrong if we talk of uniform civil code in India? But although uniform civil codes will not be codes, or they are not codes, they cannot be codes in which all Hindus of India believe. And legally speaking, Hindus include Buddhists, Sikhs, Jains also. So, but there is a Muslim opposition to uniform civil code. This shows how non-material cultures resist any kind of change. The reasons may be again several: political suspicion, or historical reasons, or maybe religious reasons, or a greater hold of religious priests on some community. Hold of religious priests from Hindus has almost gone, or new types of priests are emerging from all castes and communities, and more people understand that these priests are only making us fools. But in case of certain religious communities, the hold of religious priests is still very strong, and that may explain. But anyway, the point is that culture can be divided into two parts. Like, this is part of material culture, but what we will do with this, that is determined by this. What is this and what is to be done by this? How is this produced? What is this? This is part of material culture. How is it produced in factories? With what material? How are inputs, raw material obtained? What science, what equations, what mathematics, what chemistry, what physics is required in production of this? That is part of cognitive culture. And what we will do with this? Just because it is part of material culture, it has been produced. The moment it has been produced, it has become part of this. And there is a whole science, knowledge, mathematics, physics, chemistry, raw material, which have gone into production of this. So it's a reality now, a material reality. But what shall we do with this? We can do many things with this. Kya kar sakte hai isse? Fight we kar sakte. We can fight with this. It can serve as a weapon. It can serve as an instrument of communication. Many things can be done. What shall we do with this? And how shall we use it? How shall we use it? That is the part of normative culture. In this respect, I find that one distinction made by Gisbert between attitudes and interests is quite interesting. Since I have already mentioned about organismic theories, evolutionary conflict. I'm not spending much time on these concepts. I'm only trying to elaborate how they are applied. Organismic was an assumption that a society is like a biological organism. As in biological organism, as in case of human body or animal body, you have eyes, you have stomach, you have ears, you have legs, you have hands, brain. Likewise, in society, you have several institutions. One institution is responsible for production of food item, another institution for safety and security, another institution is dealing with religious or magical or supernatural beliefs like that. So human society is like an organism. And if it is like an organism, how does it maintain? This is how society maintains itself. This kind of conceptualization will go more with organismic theories. Evolutionary theory will deal more with how society evolves as a cell, as a small fetus gets evolved into a complex human body. A simple fetus in mother's womb subsequently grows into a complex human body with a complex brain. Like that, society also evolves from a simple, the simple form must have existed in ancient times in the stage of food gathering, wandering, and now we have a post-industrial society, a very complex society. It has evolved and it has passed through certain definite stages. And in society, we have both cooperation and conflict, and the basis of cooperation and conflict can be attitudes and interests. I thought that I must spend a few minutes clarifying the concept of attitude and interest as given in your textbook of Gisbert. Friends, one simple distinction between them, between interest and attitude. And these interests and attitudes are the basis of conflict and cooperation. Are you and me in conflict or cooperation? Is there a conflict between students and teachers or a cooperation? Now, since I said that in sociology there is no right or wrong answer, I think it all depends on the perspective. You can say that there is cooperation. You can also say that there is conflict. As for interests are objective, I will tell you in what sense we are cooperating and in what sense we are in conflict. Attitudes are individual, subjective, emotional, evaluative, we evaluate. So our attitude towards something may be favorable or unfavorable. Evaluation is involved. Attitudes are sentiments. They are individual, subjective, emotional, and evaluative. We are either in favor of something or we are against something. Interests are objective, and that means they may be common. Attitudes can be like or dislike. Your attitude and my attitude towards something may be alike or it may be dislike, but attitudes cannot be common. Interests are matters of values. You see, one can say that the relationship between teachers and students is cooperative. There is a common interest. We are cooperating because there is a common interest. objective, common, and a matter of value. What is that value? You are a new entrant to Indian society. You are younger generation. Culture means passing on of something from one generation to another. You belong to younger generation. I as a teacher belong to older generation. And there is a cooperation. You are not working for yourself. I am not working for myself. All of us are working in the interest of Indian society. And a very specific interest. That interest, what is our interest? Interest is dissemination and generation of knowledge. Our interest lies, interest is common. There is a common interest. And actually, the fact that the interest is common, this interest belongs to society. It's not your personalized attitude. It's an interest, a value. This is a value of Indian society, value of all societies. Dissemination and generation of knowledge. In dissemination and generation of knowledge, people of the previous generation and people belonging to new generation must cooperate so that the Indian society survives, develops, grows, becomes more powerful. That is the interest. And in that interest, we are cooperating. What does attitude mean? Attitude is personal, individual. It's emotional. It's evaluative and like what is our wish to acquire knowledge, or my wish to acquire knowledge, or my wish to read the subject matter of sociology and interpret this to members of new generation of Indian society. My wish, that wish is subjective, individualized, and that is a kind of attitude. With that, some emotional state is also attached. All teachers will not have common attitude. It is individual. Sentiments or wishes or desires or dreams or evaluation. Some teachers may not like teaching. They may come to teaching profession for the reason that teaching profession also permits them to do research. Their attitude. There are no common attitudes. Attitudes are personal. One teacher, similarly students, attitudes of students are emotional states they have in acquiring education. You think all the students are are alike in their attitudes, sentiments, individualized dreams, wishes, they react samely towards education? No. For some it's an enjoyment, for some it's training, for some it is instrument of getting a good job, for some they are only fulfilling their parents' wishes, for some it's a burden, unavoidable burden. So some students will study for grades, some because they have deep interest in the subject. So there are all kinds of attitudes, all kinds. Similarly, as among teachers, there are all kinds of attitudes. Among students also, there are all kinds of attitudes. Attitudes can be like or dislike, but they cannot be common. There is no common attitude of students towards education. There is no common attitude of teachers towards education. Dissemination and generation of knowledge. Not common. For some it is a job. Because they did not find any other job, so they have come to teaching profession. After all, in teaching also they are drawing good salary and they have house on the campus and safe and secure place. And we do not feel so much threatened in the presence of students of IIT Kanpur as an executive engineer of electricity will feel amidst crowd in Chalunganj. It's a very good job. Teaching is a no threat to our security. Nobody humiliates us. So some people may come because it's a good job. Like that, different people may have different attitude. How to see the relationship between teachers and students as a relationship of conflict? As there is a conflict between males and females, upper caste and lower caste, urban and rural areas, rich and poor, North India and South India, one can see that the relationship of teachers and students is also of conflict. Teachers are dadas. Students are on the receiving end. Teachers decide which book to be consulted, what to be read in the course, how many quizzes or mid-sem exams or end-sem exams be given to students, how to evaluate, how many A's and B's to give, and students are on the receiving end. Students' wish is nowhere noted. Forget about fulfilling the wishes of students. It is not even recorded anywhere. You select 2,000 best students from the whole country. Ideally speaking, the 2,000 students who are the best students of the country after 10 plus 2 must be given choice to decide for themselves what career they would like to make, whether they would go for engineering or arts or fine arts or wrestling or painting or what they want to do in life. From conflict perspective, the best youths of the country should have been given the choice. They want to become film actor, or they want to become civil engineer, or they want to become poet, or what. But in this society in which there is a big gap of power between previous generation and new generation, and in academics between teachers and students, students have absolutely no say, and teachers will decide that if you have a J rank of this, you go to computer science. If you have J rank of this, you go to civil engineering. So it's a relationship of conflict. In conflict relationship, there is a powerful group and there is a vulnerable group. Students constitute the vulnerable group. If you have this J rank, you are to be treated like Brahmins and you will go to computer science. If you have one rank less, then you go to electrical. And if your rank is this, you are like Shudras or untouchable, then you go to civil engineering or aerospace. Power. So the students' place in society is not equal. It should have been in a society free from conflicts. The place of new generation, old generation, in the interest of this should have been same. And students must have a greater say. They are going to constitute the future generation of adults in this country. They should have had better say in deciding what they want to do. But actually, the people who are going to constitute the adults of tomorrow, they are given absolutely no say. And just to make the discussion slightly light, the teaching community as powerful elite or as gundas are exercising their power. Their teachers are dabangs and students are vulnerable. So from the perspective of conflict, there is a relationship of power. And students do not even have say in deciding how they should be evaluated. Maybe some student is good at language. He can write a very good sociology assignment. Why should he be given mid-sem exam and end-sem exam? Why should he be given objective type paper? Maybe some students are not good at language. They can do better at objective type. So students should be asked. But because this society is governed by teachers, no teachers are more powerful, so students have no say. And what the teachers decide gets decided for the whole population of teachers and students. So from that point of view, it's a relationship of conflict. Whether groups are cooperating or they are in conflict depends on what sociological perspective we apply to look at the issue. Theek hai? We stop here. Thanks.